Welcome to Radio Live in New Zealand, there, Ernest. How are you, sir?
I'm very fine, thank you.
Now, you know why I'm calling. I'm calling because the King of Pop, it's his third anniversary on the 25th of June, the 26th of June here in New Zealand. What were you doing on the day that you actually heard the news of Michael Jackson?
Well, I was in Los Angeles. I was supposed to be there to have a meeting with Mr. Jackson to be being considered to be on a business day tour. And I was in Los Angeles with the Jackson's publicist, and I heard the news when I was with her, and I was completely devastated because I had just saw Jackson 5 days prior. And it was, to me, I could not find the words. I was like in total shock, and I was just crying and crying. And then, of course, the media was calling and the AP, but I knew 45 minutes before the AP knew that Michael passed away.
Right, well, let's take us back to the day, and here's the announcement from Jermaine Jackson.
This is hard. My brother, the legendary King of Pop, Michael Jackson, passed away on Thursday, June 25th, 2009 at 2:26 p.m. It is believed he suffered cardiac arrest in his home. However, the cause of his death is unknown until results of the autopsy are known. His personal physician, who was with him at the time, attempted to resuscitate my brother. And as did the paramedics who transported him to Ronald Reagan UCLA Medical Center. Upon arriving at the hospital at approximately 1:14 p.m., a team of doctors, including emergency physicians and cardiologists, attempted to resuscitate him for a period of more than 1 hour, and they were unsuccessful. Our family requests that the media please respect our privacy during this tough time. And may Allah be with you, Michael, always.
Ernest, that news here, of course, from Jermaine Jackson. You're close to the Jackson family. How close are you with the Jackson family? Of course, you're one of the only endorsed Michael Jackson impersonators endorsed by Michael. How close were you with the family there?
Well, as I said, I was there. I gave my condolences to the family. I'm not as close as everyone may think. I mean, I know them. I met them. I know LaToya. We worked together back in 2009 in Poland, and I had a long talk with her as well, and gave my condolences. All I know is, with Michael, as I did promotional work for him, and I was the only official representative for his licensed company, Mystery Drinks, which sold quite successful in Europe. And but I, as I said, the family knows of me, the estate and everything. Me and Michael, we were friends, not best friends, but friends. You know, he only called here at my home a few times, and I've only just did just work business with him. We only talked, a few times, and at those times we talked quite a good time. It was okay, but he's a great guy. But as I said, the Jackson family knows me. I'm not, very close friends of them. I've only been there, just once. I met them, gave my condolences and stuff like that. But other than that, I basically dealt with Michael and his management when it came to promotional tours and stuff like this.
All right, for our listeners who are listening in from all over the world, as well as New Zealand, you've been impersonating Michael Jackson for 37 years.
Yes.
So, when did you first become Michael Jackson?
Oh, I remember, when I saw Michael as a kid, I saw him on television. I used to watch him doing the cartoons and things like this, and I started when I was 8 years old. my family, you know, especially my mother, they thought it was a rebellion thing, you know, because I devoted all my time just on Michael Jackson. I mean, at that time, I was completely obsessed with Michael. I mean, I drank, ate, and slept Michael Jackson. My whole room, my walls were completely paced with just Michael Jackson. And I had no support from my family. I mean, they, you know, my stepfather, he hated Michael. My mother and the rest of my siblings, they liked Michael, but it wasn't, you know, not like how I did. And I mean, I loved him, and I still do with all my heart. And, you know, I used to hitchhike to shows because my mother would refuse to take me to shows. So it was very, very difficult to me. And then I just started. I had my own little Jackson group. You know, I had my own Tito, Randy, Marlon, you know, and we did shows around Florida, things like this. And we won many, many talent shows. And we opened up tours for New Edition. I personally opened up a couple of tours for a couple of shows, I'm sorry, for Cyndi Lauper. I mean, we did quite a bit, and I work with Cher here in Germany also. So I've done quite a bit. And since then, I mean, I'm the only impersonator who's been doing it for 37 years. And on my birthday, October 6th this year, it will be 38 years. And I've done over 6,000 shows as I worked here in an amusement park here in Europe, where I did 6 to 8 shows per day. And that's where the 6,000 shows came from.
That's a lot of shows and a lot of moonwalking and trying to imitate Michael. So, and that hasn't made you grow tired of doing it. It's probably given you more enthusiasm to just keep on going.
Well, actually, I have to admit, when Michael passed away, I didn't want to perform anymore because for me, my friend and mentor was gone, and I felt no reason to perform anymore. And I just didn't want to do it, so I kind of retreated. I basically, you know, became a recluse. I didn't want to do it anymore, and my wife, she kept on me saying, no, this is not what Michael would want, and I just didn't care anymore. And then suddenly, you know, she, after weeks and weeks, she started talking to me more and more, and I said, okay, you know, because it was all about the message, you know, trying to get people to understand what Michael Jackson stood for. And this is what I've been doing, my mission, what I'm doing now. This is the only reason why I'm impersonating Michael Jackson, because I'm trying to get people to understand that Michael spent his entire life advocating, trying to teach us all globally that love is the answer to all problems, and we need to love each other, help each other without conditions, and to be able to be there for each other and to stop fighting. I mean, all problems can be resolved if we all just, you know, sit down and talk about the issue and show unconditional love and not try to, you know, want something in return or have bad intentions. I mean, because we have that. And Michael Jackson, to me, was a messenger of God. He had that purity. He had that, I mean, that the whole pure, like an angel, you know, where all he wanted to do was help people. That's all he ever did. And he helped everyone. That's why he was in the Guinness Book of World Records for giving to most charity. If Michael Jackson wouldn't have given any money to no one, he would have been a zillionaire. I mean, the guy had everything, but all he did was give most of his money, the majority of his money, to helping people. That's what he was all about.
That's
just
right.
Helping people, and that's what he tried to tell us.
Right. Well, I was just wondering if you can explain to me. I'm just going to play something, and when we come back, I want you to explain to me a little bit more about this.
Listen, the reason why I'm here this evening is to speak about Michael, of course. And, you know, I love Michael Jackson very much. I really do. And as we all know, God only made one Michael Jackson. Only one. Nobody, no one can ever replace Michael Jackson. So what I am here to talk to you about is that all my career, I have been through MJ forms, watching how the Michael Jackson fans cooperate with each other. And the thing what I have noticed is that there is, that love is not there. The main message about Michael, love, peace, and unity.
Yes. Can you tell me whereabouts you spoke there, Ernest? That was at some presentation for Michael Jackson fans?
Yes, it was at MJ Honors. What I wanted to do, because I found a problem that no one else refused to speak about, and I felt it was time to bring this problem to the surface and to address it, because, you know, Michael and his fans, us, the problem needs to start with us before we can advocate out to the world. And that is, I've noticed within Michael's fans, the community, there's all this fighting. You know, there's always, it's like this person, you know, saying, you know, I did more, or I love Michael Jackson more, or they're basically sexing him down. I'm talking about, you know, it's his body and this and that. And I was trying to explain to everyone that, listen, we, you know, let's not let Michael die in vain. You know, let's not make his death be in vain. We need to really work on each other, to work and to love each other in harmony as one people. Because if we are unable to bring ourselves together as one, as Michael's army of love, then how can we advocate to the world about Michael's message if we're not practicing that? And this is what I was trying to explain to them, because all I see in forums and everything is people, the fans, fighting. I mean, it's amazing, Jason, what I hear, how they treat each other. And I'm saying, this is not what Michael would want. If you have a problem with someone, you wish that person well, but don't trash that person. I mean, Michael had enough of that from the media. So you would think his own fans would understand what he went through. And all I wanted is for us to, you know, to step back and pay attention and to look at the problem. It's not worth trashing everybody like the media did Michael, you know, and to try to get along with each other. And this is something I became very, very upset about. This is why I had to do that, because someone had to address that issue.
Well, it appears that lots of Michael Jackson fans have started to unite together. When we come back from the break there, Ernest, I'll talk to you about how you'll remember Michael on his third anniversary. But before we go and take that break, I'd like you to introduce one of your favorite songs of Michael Jackson's. We'll play that to the break and then come back and talk to you more.
My favorite song of Michael Jackson is Man in the Mirror, because he states it very clearly that if you want to make the world a better place, take a look at yourself and make the change. And this is something I also would like for everyone to really try to understand, that Michael's songs have a message in it. And this particular one means we have to look at ourselves and to change and to stop fighting and just change for the better. We all can become more than what we have become.
I wanna make a change. For once in my life, it's gonna feel real good. Gonna make a difference. Gonna make it right. As I turn up the collar on my favorite winter coat, this wind is blowing my mind. I see the kids in the street, but not enough to eat. Who am I to be blind, pretending not to see them need? A sonorous disregard, a broken bottle top, and a one-man show. They follow each other on the wind, you know, 'cause they got nowhere to go. That's why no one yet to know. Change his ways, and no message could have been
Right, welcome back, there, Ernest. It's a powerful message in that song, Man in the Mirror, from Michael Jackson. When do you think the world's going to start listening to that sort of message?
Well, I'm hoping, I mean, I always have hope for humanity. I think because of Michael's passing, which unfortunately it took his demise for people to wake up and understand what he actually stood for. So I think slowly people are beginning to recognize and to understand. But the problem is, because I know in life you have to have a balance. You have bad and you have good. But we must strive to become better so we can make the bad to start diminish, you know, because it is possible, but each of us must take the initiative to want to become a better person, everyone. And this is something, even me, I mean, being 46 years old, I'm still working on myself to be a better person. This is what I'm trying to ask and to speak to everyone, to do the exact same thing. And by doing this, we can create and become a better world, a better person, and what God gave us. We can, but we have to take the initiative to become a better person.
Ernest, would you mind answering some of the questions from some of your fans now who have emailed me asking if I can ask you some questions, if that's okay?
Sure.
Now, I have a question here. Have you always liked Michael Jackson, and what other influences do you have musically?
Well, I've always loved Michael Jackson. I mean, all my life I have loved him. He's my life. He's everything to me. I have learned everything from him. And I have one male who I love very much. That's Michael Jackson. And my female was Whitney Houston, who also just passed away. And, you know, I learned a lot from her as well. She has a beautiful, beautiful voice. But from these two and listening to classical music, and I'm very philosophical, and Michael Jackson, I love his philosophies about life and things like this. So basically, I love Michael Jackson always, and also Whitney Houston.
Person that's emailed, his name's Joey Stevenson, and he says, "Dear Jason, I have one question for Ernest Valentino. Do you, Ernest, send autographs through the mail?"
Well, I do give autographs, but usually I do that when I have shows. It's kind of strange because I don't consider myself to be a celebrity, if you will. I'm just an impersonator trying to do the right thing, trying to help Michael Jackson, when he was alive, and now trying to spread his message even more. But as far as autographs, I mean, yes, I do, but that's when people bring their own, whether it's a piece of paper or an album of Michael, and I sign my name on it. But in generally, I don't give out autographs because I just don't see myself on that level, if you will.
Right, we have another question here too, mainly concerning your wife. What's it like for your wife to have to live and share her time between you as Michael Jackson and you as Ernest Valentino?
Well, my wife is, she loves Michael Jackson just as much as I do, probably if not more. She was devastated also when the news came, when Michael passed, just completely, called me on and on and asking me to please do something. She loves me for who I am. She has watched me evolve. I met her, when she was a dancer. She was a professional dancer, and she auditioned for me. But she doesn't see a major, difference. She loves me for who I am. There's a lot of similarities between me and Michael, and she sees that. But, she loves me for who I am, and that's something that I'm very thankful.
And another question from Peter Well, who says, "What is it like to be able to give a piece back of Michael to all of his fans?"
I'm sorry, could you repeat that, please?
The question is, what is it like to be able to give a piece of Michael to all of his fans?
Well, I love what I do, and what's important to me is to be able to give people the message of Michael Jackson. I know a lot of people love Michael Jackson. They like to see him dance. They love his music. And I do too. But if I am able to help change people in a positive way, even if it's just one person, then it lets me know that I've done my job well. I feel really honored that a lot of fans, they support me in this, and I try my best to do it as best as I can, really. It is a big task, and so far I think I'm doing, quite of a good job with it. I think I am, because I know what Michael stood for, and I know his soul is something that I feel when I'm performing. So I'm very thankful. I'm very honored to be able to show the fans and the world what Michael really stood for, and that's what matters, and hopefully they could be able to take that message into their soul and to be able to recondition their minds to become a better person.
All right. We have another message here from Romania. You apparently are like royalty in Romania. People love and miss you in Romania. So just peace and love to Ernest here from Romania is one of the messages I have here for you, Ernest.
I love Romania. I love the people there. The hospitality was just absolutely beautiful. Every time when I'm there, for me, it's like being at home. They are really great people. I see why Michael loved Romania, and I see why he made Romania the only concert official video, because Romanian people are just great. I love them so much, and I'm really working on to come back there to be able to do another show if possible. But they are beautiful people, and I miss them very much, and I want them to know that I really do love them a lot from my heart.
And I imagine that's the same for your fans in Germany as well. What's it like living life in Germany as Michael?
Actually, here in Germany, I'm very recluse. I don't really go out. The Germans, I love the Germans. They're very nice people. Michael loved Germany. He loved Germany. He came here quite a bit. I mean, he was right here at the Hyatt where I live nearby, and which I also saw him. Germany is just, it's a great country. I love it. I've been here for some time. I mean, his fans, they're very devoted, and we have done so much for Michael here in Germany. And the Germans themselves, they love Michael. They really do. And that's why Michael came here also quite a few times, because they really love him. That's where he got the Bambi Award, which I was there. And after he received the Bambi Award, my wife called him and spoke to him on the phone. She begged me to call him. And so we spoke to him on the phone briefly to congratulate him on the Bambi Award. So, yes, I love Germany. So it's a beautiful country.
Right. Well, before we go to another break and things there, let's talk about your show. We haven't really spoken much about your show. Now, I've had a chance to check out some of your shows on YouTube and MySpace and things. I've put photos up against Michael Jackson. And to tell you the truth, there are some times I'm not even sure who I'm looking at.
Well, thank you, Jason. I am thankful what God gave me. I have a photographic memory, so I'm able to look at Michael and be able to produce, to copy what he's done. I've never taken dance classes other than when I met my wife, and then she showed me how to count, because I remember when she came to, when she was one of my dancers, they would ask me, "So Ernest, what is the count?" And I'd be like, "What count?" And I just know what went where, but didn't know what counting was. So I'm very thankful for that gift that I have. And just, I don't know, when I met, when I was 2002 at the Killer Thriller Party in London, when Michael was there, we had a brief private moment on stage, which of course is confidential. I can't tell anybody that. But afterwards, Michael told me how much he really enjoyed my show, that he's never, ever seen anyone perform him with such passion, and he was captivated. He told me that himself. And I told him, I said, "Michael, you know why I impersonate you?" And he says, "Ernest, I know," and smiled. He's a great man, and I really try my best to give them the illusion, because that's what it is when it comes to impersonation. It's about illusion, whether it's 20 minutes, 30 minutes, an hour, or 90 minutes. When you are performing, copying someone, impersonating someone, the audience has to think that they're actually watching the real thing. Now, even though we all know Michael has passed, the illusion still must be there. That's what it's all about. And if you're able to do that, then you have successfully achieved and accomplished that task, which is not really easy, because Michael Jackson, I mean, everyone knows it's his soul which shines through his artistic performance. Everybody sees that, you know, from his eyes, the way he just stands there. I mean, he's the only guy who can stand there for 90 seconds and not move, and the crowd goes ballistic. You know, so you have to have those qualities that Michael Jackson has, and if you don't have any of those, it's really, really, it's almost impossible.
Now, through your show there, I mean, you don't necessarily have to tell me what comes where, but how far back in the show do you go? Do you go back to the Jackson 5 era, or where do you start?
I started back in the Afro days, the bell bottoms, if you will. That's what I was wearing. I won my first trophy in 1976. I was performing Dancing Machine, and I was wearing, back then, I was wearing these glitter socks, and I actually performed with those socks with no shoes on. And that's when I won my first trophy. And from then on, I started winning more and more and more contests. But there was one show, I have to admit, there was one show that they actually booed me off stage.
I'm not afraid
to admit that. They actually booed me off stage. I cried. I was in tears. But I was even more determined then. And then I got back up, brushed myself off, and I just became more and more and more, more vigorously, just more, you know, no one couldn't tell me anything. And then since then, it's been success and success and success.
Did you get up, brush yourself off, and blame it on the boogie?
Exactly. Because, you know, every crowd is different. You don't know how it's going to be, and I'm always nervous on every single show. But I learn a lot, you know, because when something like that happens, you don't supposed to be, of course you're going to be upset, but you have to learn from your mistakes. You have to learn, look at yourself and go, okay, this wasn't right, that wasn't right, and you take that information and you work on that. So that's what I did. I mean, I taught myself how to spin barefoot in my room, you know, when I was little. I didn't know how to spin, but when I saw Michael Jackson spin and how many times he spun, I was just captivated. So I went in my room and I was trying to spin, and my mother could hear me bouncing and crashing to the closet doors. You know, but finally I got it right and I was able to know how to spin. And I taught myself how to spin on my toes barefoot as well, because in Florida, you don't really need any socks and shoes.
I bet. Now, your family now, do they sort of, now that you are Michael Jackson, well, you know, the closest thing to Michael Jackson, your family, I bet they're right behind you now, are they, even though they're a bit skeptical to start with?
I can say that they're proud of me. Whether or not I have their support, that's another question. I mean, you know, I love my family. You know, it's always been a bit of a unfortunate, a bit of a wedge, if you will, between me and my family when it comes to Michael Jackson. I mean, because, you know, when I look back to then see that I had no support, I mean, even now, you know, when we talk, we don't talk about Michael Jackson, because, you know, it's just me and my family, but I don't think I get the same support as I do then. If I do, I don't know about it, but they have told me that they're proud of me and things like that, so that's what matters.
Well, just know, too, that around the world, Ernest Valentino has another family as well. I mean, nothing as good as your own family, but around the world, I've had messages from Japan, China, Bulgaria, all over the world. You have this big family who are just reaching out and saying, keep going.
Well, you know, my goal, my dream, if you will, I want to do, literally, because everybody, I receive emails from Japan, from around the world, and Michael was supposed to do the O2 Arena, the This Is It tour that everybody wanted to see, and those who never got a chance and saw Michael, their hearts were just broken. And for us, for us who have seen him and wanted to see him, you know, this last time, because Michael said this is last curtain call, meaning that was his last, that was going to be his last concert. So what I would like to do for everyone, I would like to do literally a 100-day tour around the world, literally, for everybody to be able to get a chance to at least I can give them a little something, a little of something. That's all. I mean, nobody can be MJ. Of course not. Nobody. He's irreplaceable. You know, there's only one Michael Jackson. But I would like to at least give them just a small part of an illusion that what they may have been able to be prepared for. And, you know, if that's possible, then my dream would have come true.
Well, we'll hold that thought for a moment and just get back to This Is It. He liked to trick people, so I hear that possibly you may have been part of some sort of event, if you're able to elaborate a bit more about that, at the O2 Arena. Were you going to be employed to help with a certain stunt?
Well, one thing I can say is that they were looking for someone who looked like Michael Jackson, and most importantly, that person had to have Michael's physique. And since I have Michael's physique, I was being considered, because there were other impersonators who wanted to, and they would say either you were too short or, you know, you didn't look like Michael. But I was being considered, and the job was to basically, you know, like when Michael do certain tricks, you know, I would be like, you know, there, and Michael would be, you know, I'll be here, Michael would be over there. And it's pretty much like what he did, for example, during the Dangerous Tour with the little astronaut thing at the end.
Yes.
Okay, that wasn't Michael. Michael was already gone. So, or when he did from Thriller to I think it's from Thriller to Beat It, you know, with the scary mask, you know, from Thriller, you know, that was someone else, and, you know, Michael was already gone. So, you know, but this is necessary for certain tricks, of course. And I would have been the one, because the physique was very, very necessary. That was the top thing that had to be, because Michael wanted to do several tricks, which I'm not aware of, by the way. I didn't know, because the meeting never took place. But there were going to be several tricks, and I'm assuming, I'm just speculating here, that the reason, you know, they needed that for someone to look like Michael, to have his physique, and then Michael can go and do something else, because he was very extravagant when it came to special effects and tricks. So in this particular thing here, he really wanted to be perfect. And I was the only one who actually had Michael's physique. I mean, LaToya told me in 2009 when we were in Poland, when I was in the room with her, talking to her, she just looked at me and she says, "You have my brother's body." And, you know, and she tried on my jacket, my presentation jacket, and she just said, "Oh, you know, how beautiful the jacket was." And she just told me, "You have my brother's body." And I said, "Yeah, you know, a lot of people told me that too." I mean, she's a very nice lady. I mean, I love her very much. She's really, really, really nice. So, LaToya, if you're listening, I would love to be able to reconnect, because there are a lot of things I'd like to speak with you about. But anyway, yes, just to... it was most importantly the physique, and this is just to do these little transitions to make these special effects and these tricks, you know, look really surreal to the audience.
How can we get you to New Zealand? That's the big thing, because have you ever performed in New Zealand there?
I've never been there. I've heard about it. It's a beautiful country. I mean, the landscapes and everything, and it's just absolutely breathtaking. I would make sure, I mean, seriously, I would make sure that I would go there, because I want everyone to get a chance to get a piece, even if it's just a small piece of what Michael Jackson would have done, just a small piece of the illusion, a small piece of love, and also to hear the message, which, of course, is important. I want to be able to do all the great countries, you know, all over 100, I would say 100 dates over the course of 2 years. And just try to do as much as possible. Then after that, then all I want to do is just do charity events, as I've always done.
Right, and I hear that you're working with someone pretty close to you at the moment who is looking at trying to help you get to New Zealand. So fingers crossed that that comes off. And
yes, I do. I'm hoping that too.
Yeah, and we'd love to see you here. Now finally, the most important thing is the anniversary of Michael Jackson. Ernest Valentino, how will you spend the day?
Well, I can tell you, Jason, I'm basically, I've never been the same since Michael passed. And every year now, it's like he just passed yesterday. I won't lie to you and I won't lie to anyone else. I'm basically a basket case. I mean, I lost my friend, I lost my mentor, and I feel like everyone else does. We lost the greatest entertainer in the world. And life is just, of course life goes on, but you're just never the same. It's like a part of my soul is missing. And June 25th, I don't do anything on that day. I'm completely a wreck. I just basically hang about and, play Michael's music. And I'm just in tears because I for some reason, though I know he's no longer with us, I have a problem accepting that. It's just, I don't know. I just never thought that it would be this soon. I mean, I had a dream about 5-7 years ago. I told my wife, Michael Jackson is going to pass away in his 50s. And she said, why would you say that? I said, I don't know. I have this feeling. I said, but I don't know when, in his 50s, but he's going to pass away. She said, how do you know that? I said, because geniuses, Michael Jackson was an extraordinary genius. They never lived long, you know, and Michael Jackson was a multi-extraordinary genius. And I knew that he was not going to be with us for long. I knew that. I mean, think about it, Jason. Michael Jackson had everything, literally everything. It was like his talents, and I mean talents with plural. It was unlimited. He could dance, draw. He looked good. He was able to do everything. I mean, literally everything. He was just multi-talented, and there's no other artist on this planet who is like that, only Michael. That's why God only chose one. And I tell people, Michael Jackson is one in a lifetime. We would never have something like that again. Not in this lifetime. It won't happen. That's why when I hear people say, oh, this person's like Michael, I'm like going, no, nowhere near close. You know, but Monday, I'm going to be a wreck. I'm always a wreck. It just, because it's hard coping. It really is.
Just know that a lot of people around the world are also going through the same thing, and hopefully you can feel some of that love around the world radiating back towards you in Germany.
Yes, I want everyone to know we are all an ocean of tears, and Michael Jackson lives in all of us, and it's up to us to make sure that he stays alive and to spread that message. What he stood for, because he's looking down on all of us, and he wants us to do the right thing, to look inside ourselves, to make a change, to become better than what we've become. That is very, very important. I can't stress it enough. That is the only sole reason why I'm impersonating Michael. It's for that reason alone. That's it. That's all that matters to me. And Michael and I, with all of us around the world, I want everyone to know they're not alone, and they're all in my prayers, and they're all with, we're all together, crying together for one tear, one nation, and one people.
Well, that sentiment alone there just took me back to the announcement of Michael Jackson's death there, so that was rather powerful there, Ernest. So thank you so much for actually joining us this morning on Radio Live in New Zealand, and we wish you all the best, and keep on keeping on.
Thank you very much, Jason. Thank you so much. I love you and I love everyone in Zealand. Thank you so much for having me.
And before you go, we're going to finish on one of your other songs now. Kind of sums everything up, really. I'll let you introduce the next song, Ernest.
It's another song that's very dear to me. It's called Keep Your Head Up, because I want everyone to know, even though Michael's not with us, We have to keep our head up. We have to be strong for Michael. We must strive forward to become better than what we are. And to show Michael we have learned and we understand.
Unas Valentino, thank you so much for joining us here on Radio Live. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Jason, and God bless you.
She's looking for a job and to find a place to stay. She's looking for the hope in the empty promises. She's working two jobs, keeping alive. She works in a restaurant night and day. She waits her life away. She wipes the tears away.
She cries inside every time she feels this way. And she's dying inside every time her baby cries. No,
keeping your head up to the sky, keeping your mind up, stay alive. Give me your wings so we can fly. Rise up, tell me now. Give me your wings so we can fly. We're killing up the life in the birds and the trees. And we're sucking up the air in the earth from under me.
It's never too late.
I can't even breathe. I can't even see. Keep your head up. Wish that love would come today.
All you need is love.